lose when you chop food up. What you lose is essentially what we call fractionation versus fractality. So what the tingle was in the whole apple was the long wave. Electrically, it was because the apple had consumed the charge of the earth it grew in, and the charge was a wave within a wave within a wave within a wave. And the spin was the food. Well, hi there. In the West, what we do is we chop up our grains, which is to say fractionate them, and then we think of our world as particles. Whereas in the East, they eat their grains whole, which is to say they eat the long wave, and they think of their world as one. And so it helps us to understand that the process of chopping up our food too much, fractionating the memory in the food, has actually cost us context richness. It has cost us embedding. It's cost us the way to occupy or inhabit the long wave. In Surfers of the Cebuya by Jose Argüelles, he says, "Ride the long wave, Uncle Joe." And what he means by that, literally, is that if you can't feel and eat the long wave in your food and in your plants and in your earth, then you won't be able to feel the larger being bodies that inhabit the world around us. And so you're then condemned to separateness and fractionation. What we'd like to suggest, first of all, is A, that in terms of hygiene and practice then, it's critical to be able to feel a magnetic field. You literally need to be able to feel magnetism with your hands. You can do it with dowsing and pendulums, that's fine, but eventually you refine that skill until you do it with yourself. And the ultimate other thing that you need to be able to do is when you walk into a grocery store and you make choices, you need to be able to feel what life force is, because that's the food. And life force, we understand it electrically now, it's charge embedding. And life force is lost every time the food touches something metal, every time it's chopped up some more, every time its DNA is fractionated. Whereas when the food comes fresh from the earth, full of that charge embedding of a living, life-bubbling, organic field, then there's life force in the food. And that feeds the long wave in your body, which makes for good sex. It also makes for good spirituality. Same thing, you come to the spirit as you would to a lover. Some other practical things that in terms of the suggested exercises here is that once you're able to feel a magnetic field, you make a map of your bed, make a magnetic map of your house, and you make a magnetic map of your backyard. And once you begin to get the idea of where the magnetic lines look like beautiful rose petals, there beautiful things grow, people and flowers. Whereas the magnetic lines are dizzy, then the people are dizzy and so are the plants. Some ways to do this include if you install a labyrinth or a stone circle where you braid the magnetism. The labyrinth, for example, you can read about this at danwinter.com/labyrinth, labyrinth. But the labyrinth is simply the shadow of the seven-color donut on the land where it's this turning inside-out-ness, and it creates this dimpling force. And where there is the ability to dimple, there is the ability to begin sorting magnetic lines. So let's look at a picture. So the labyrinth is essentially oriented magnetically. This is an exercise in how to make sacred space in your backyard. The mouth of the labyrinth, north, south, east, or west, will determine its quality, what magnetism it's attracting. And it's a way of creating sacred space by actively using paramagnetic stones carefully chosen to create that folding, which creates the dimpling force. And if we look, really what's happening there is the labyrinth is a two-dimensional or planar flatland projection of the seven spins on the surface of the seven-color donut Mobius. So it's really a magnetic donut learning how to create that dimpling relationship of the penis to the vagina in that sense. And if we zoom down here, we see that the one-dimensional turning inside out, which is right at the beginning there, the Greek key. Do you see the Greek key there? If you revolve the Greek key, you have in two dimensions the planar labyrinth, which is simply the sequence of turns you'd make to turn inside out on flat land. So when you reach the center of the labyrinth, even if you're riding a horse on a horse labyrinth, you create a common center of gravity turn inside out point by which man and horse become one. And in the same process, man and the earth can become one by entering the dimpling point. So that's another example of creating sacred space on your land, whether it's a stone circle, whether it's using paramagnetic stones or dolmens. It's to get the idea that structures in the earth, like limestone, unlike sandstone — sandstone will fractionate the magnetism, but paramagnetic structures like limestone will be a lens for magnetic field. So you make pretty pictures out of the magnetism on your land, and then you inhabit that field. It's a kind of a case of prepare the field and she will come. But it's really more like, if you have intense bliss, Kundalini for example, you will ultimately not be able to be sane, to support that spin density, unless you inhabit a landscape where, when you look out in your backyard, that too is fractal. And the other thing, of course, is that you do that in places in time which are also fractal. That's the meaning of the solar calendar and the Tutankhamun prophecies and the Mayan calendar. It's all a map of how to embed yourself in the solar patterns, because we need to be fractal in time as well as fractal in space. And speaking of which, we're almost out of time on this section of our presentation, but we wanted to summarize at least by saying, while we didn't go into all the details here — there's a lot at the article on the Twinkling Eyes Lifestyle, again, danwinter.com/health, but the principles behind this, that once you learn that it is spin density that's the same as awareness density, you'll never look at a table of food or a house in the same way again. Because even when you look at a table of food, you look for life force. Now when you look at a house, like this beautiful one we've been playing at for the last few days, it's paramagnetic stone, there's ceramic, there's clay, and there's a minimum of metal. Because metal shorts out magnetic lines, particularly heavy metals, whereas the ancient paramagnetic structures were always, like temples, were always paramagnetic stone and glass, and things that would create sacred space by embedding magnetism. So these are all things that we need to learn to do in order to make bliss possible in our lives. My suggestion is that, in fact, religion, when you sort of eliminate the personality worship, is the pure principle of the hygiene to permit bliss. And I further believe strongly, as we've said throughout here, that we could reprioritize even political governments on our planet to recognize that if the only way genetic material survives is to embed itself ultimately into stars, and bliss, the way that charge density gets DNA up to speed, is the way genetic memory survives, then truly, from an absolutely logical perspective, bliss is the function of DNA, and therefore should be the function of governments. That governments that teach that bliss is the priority would serve different food at McDonald's. They would teach the children bliss process. They would show that land building and house building and where you place a highway would always check to see if the sacred magnetism through the land was going to survive, because the magnetic field and the bliss field are one. So we hope that this has been fun for you, and would like to suggest that this is only the beginning, that once you take this pure principle of fractality and embedding and charge density and inhabiting spin to heart, that you learn that you could actively make choices to make more bliss possible in your daily life. And it starts with relaxing, because when you relax, you embed in a longer wave. So let's relax together now as we say goodbye and enter the spin together. Have a great day. Thanks for joining us. Bye.